presentation on mechanical testing of offshore blades in SGRE. Lars, time is yours, please.
Yes, thank you very much for the introduction. I would like to start out with a short presentation of Siemens Gamesa. Siemens Gamesa is one of the largest original equipment manufacturers in the wind energy industry, with a total of more than 100 gigawatt of installed wind turbines. Just as a comparison, that corresponds to an equivalent of roughly 700 nuclear power plant reactors. We have 26,000 employees and an annual revenue of around or just short of 10 billion euro. And one of the things that is noteworthy about Siemens Gamesa is that it's a true global manufacturer with the business both in the onshore and a significant business in the offshore industry, as well as the service of the wind turbine blades. In onshore, I think we are the third in the market, but in offshore, we are a clear market leader, and I am in the offshore business unit, and we'll talk a bit about the design approach that we have over here. To give a bit of history on where we are coming from, the industry is a very new industry, less than 20 years old commercially. Siemens started to engage in 2004 by procuring a Danish company called Bonus AS. And at that time, so 16 years ago, the maximum size of a wind turbine was 40 meters, 40 meter length, the blade length. And in those 16 years, we have grown to more than 97 meter that we have released on a prototype. And we are in the design and development of a turbine that has a 108 meter blade. And as such, it's the largest composite structure in the world. And I think it's a fairly amazing feat that we have been able to grow the wind energy size that dramatically just within 1.5 decades. To put a bit of reference in the size of the turbines, I took a picture of the largest offshore prototype that we have currently installed and put a picture on scale next to it of the highest building in Poland. And you can see that it's a very large machine that we're talking here. And we are installing, I think, between 300 and 400 units annually. The design process at Siemens Gamesa, we use a V-model approach in breaking down the design requirements from a turbine on a rotor level, eventually on blade level, and then segmentize that further on blade structural design, on the manufacturing aspects, on the subcomponent, eventually until we are down at material level. To match that, breakdown in requirements, we integrate the validation plan by starting from bottoms up and using a building block approach in doing so. So we have extensive validation in material qualification and substructure validation, and then gradually increase the complexity of the units that we're testing until we have a full blade test and eventually a prototype test turbine that we are running in field. And I will be mainly talking about the material qualification and the substructure validation at Siemens Gamesa. A wind turbine blade is built out of several features, I would say, structural features. So we have in our design a single web integrated into an I-beam structure. And the flanges of the I-beam structure, that is really what carries the loads of the wind turbine when it's operating and feeling the aerodynamic forces. And then we have a panel around the I-beam to generate the aerodynamic shape. And as you can imagine, each of those regions, be it the flanges, be it the web, be it the shell, has its own dedicated material design, and as such also its own test requirements. Overall, we are looking for materials that are very cost effective, have a high stiffness and strength, and at the same time are reliable and easy to manufacture. Cost is one of the major drivers in our industry, and it is what we are trying to match. And the cost level is very different from aeronautical applications. At the same time, we have a set of what we call functional materials, meaning our coatings, our leading edge protection, lightning protection system, as well as aerodynamic add-ons. And again, for those, we have an own dedicated validation plan built up. If you look at the typical characterizations that we perform for composite materials, we are typically starting off with the static characterization of the material, meaning we determine the fiber content and the fiber volume fraction. And then we take a step and in a static way determine the actual properties and the shear properties of the material. So Young's modulus and strength parameters. And we actually go through a lot of different candidate materials in screening. And if we are satisfied with the performance, especially in elastic stiffness over mass, then we proceed to the next level. Elastic stiffness is one of the most driving requirements for a wind turbine blade. As you can imagine, under the wind loads, the blade performs substantially up to 10-15 meters in extreme cases. And we need to have enough stiffness to be able to prevent that the blade deforms into the tower. So once we are satisfied with those materials on the static level, we move into the fatigue testing. Typically, a wind turbine blade is designed for a mix of static load cases and fatigue load cases. For the fatigue load cases, you can imagine that if you have turbulence, you have varying wind speeds, you have gravitational loads that all act on the wind turbine blade at different stages of the rotation. You get a complex shape of dynamic loads. And what we typically do is we post-process them into a Markov matrix and then evaluate the loads at the different R ratios. And that we also match with our material testing. So we have a set of our own in-house test methodologies developed with the external institutes. One is IMA in Dresden. Other ones could be DTU or Fraunhofer, where we have our own methodology developed to evaluate dog bone-like specimens to find the test ratios that we are mostly interested in based on our load simulations of the wind turbine blades. We also have a portfolio of tests that we do in case there is a damage on our wind turbine blade. So we typically perform a root cause analysis, and we have a toolbox that helps us to find what initiated a failure. And that is typically fiber volume fraction measurements. We rely heavily on microscopy, but we also have a set of non-destructive testing reaching from shearography to X-ray to infrared evaluation. And typically they allow us to trace back the origin of a damage to why we have this, and then we can use that to prevent the damage from reoccurring. For the core material, it's a slightly different test setup where we normally test in actual machines the laminate properties. We test the bending setups to determine the stiffness, mainly the shear stiffness of the core materials, which are predominantly used in the shell design of our blades. Then we have a set of mechanical tests on the adhesion, And that can be regular glue-like adhesives, but it can also be adhesive or adhesions between precasted elements and infused elements. So you could imagine we are pre-producing some of our wind turbine blade components and assembling them together in a co-infusion process. And by that, we define an interface, and we want to ensure that the adhesion properties are sufficient to guarantee the lifetime of our wind turbine blade. We have, again, a set of different test setups that we use as standard. Could be double cantilever beam, could be shear strength. And what we also quite often test is process variation in the production. So different opening times, different surface activation in order to optimize our product portfolio. Once we have completed those material level evaluations, we move one step up and start to evaluate on a component level. These component level tests, I just display the webfoot test that we quite often do. They're normally custom designed to the application. So typically we want to investigate a specific feature of our blade design and set design limits for our full scale blades. And that can either be a nominal design value, or that can also be acceptance criteria for smaller delaminations, dry spots, repairs that we carry out, wrinkle criterions, you name it, anything in principle that can go slightly wrong in the production of composite materials on a large scale. As I said, we use these building blocks to condensate our design parameters into design rules, and then hand over these design rule allowables to our product design. Having said that, the improvement of our materials is one of the key enablers for the growth of our wind turbine blades and the cost reduction and the generation of more electricity. So we are currently out improving our component performance, be it fabric, be it resin, could also be resin uptake. But we are currently always out to scope for improved materials that can offer us a cost benefit in the industry. So if you have any specific topics that you would like to discuss with us, or anything specific you want to discuss on testing methodology that you think could be useful for us, we are very open to take a small meeting and see if we could mutually benefit from this. We also participate in university projects sort of develop our knowledge base inside the company. And again, here, if you are interested in starting a collaboration or have an idea on what could be beneficial to the industry, please reach out. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention.